I have, you know, if I hope my understanding of the audience is good in the sense that I've written a colloquium assuming most of you are theorists, but many of you are not particle theorists. And so that is my, that's the aim of the talk, and certainly those, if I fail to meet that aim, please ask questions for clarification. I think you're probably all aware that back a few years ago, the particles that we knew in nature, which are listed here, formed an incomplete set. That is to say, you can't write a unitary quantum field theory of these particles alone. And that was known for quite some time. And the simplest theoretical fix for this problem was also known, in fact, all the way back since the 1960s. And that was to add to this set of particles, the quarks and the leptons and the known gauge bosons for the forces other than gravity, was to add a single field, which I'll call H. It's often called the Higgs field. I'll try to call it the H in this talk. And its associated spin zero boson. And the purpose of this field is to give mass to all the other fields on this list, at least those that have mass, because otherwise it's impossible to write down a unitary theory of their masses. Now, this was the idea. This is called the standard model of particle physics. It's the simplest theoretical repair. It's certainly not the only possible theoretical repair. There are far more complicated versions of this idea. But this is the simplest one. And that was the theoretical situation until the Large Hadron Collider began running around 2010. And by 2012, a new particle had been found, which was a strong candidate for this guy right here. And in the meantime, the Large Hadron Collider experimentalists were looking for many other possible particles that they knew about, and indeed anything that would violate this standard model, this simplest repair. And nothing has been found so far. So one could ask, if one were particularly nasty, is particle physics over? At least the type of particle physics that has been done culminating in the Large Hadron Collider. And, you know, it's certainly true that by 2013, we had pretty strong evidence that this is like an H. We still don't know it's the H. It might be just one of several Higgs particles. It might be that it's got properties that don't really match the standard model. But up to now, we don't have any evidence of any violation. And certainly, this was enough evidence for the Nobel Prize to be awarded and for some people to at least be mentioned in the context of that Nobel Prize. And as of today, this particle still resembles the simplest possible H boson, and there's nothing that violates the standard model in the data that we can confirm. And so, you know, why don't we think we're done? Well, there are two reasons. One is perhaps less important, and that is that the standard model is consistent and self-consistent and consistent with data, but it's not a complete theory. There are many questions that it leaves unanswered. However, we're not guaranteed that the answer answers to those questions will come at the LHC. We can hope for that. There's no guarantee. But the thing which is really disturbing from a theoretical point of view is that this theory suffers from a naturalness puzzle. And indeed, it's the second worst naturalness puzzle in science. And this causes a theoretical crisis. Now, I'm going to clarify what naturalness means if there's any question. But let me start with that. So again, this is the simplest theoretical repair to particle physics, is to add this particle. And the data seems to agree with it so far. But we know this isn't a complete theory, and we know it has a severe puzzle. All right, so what is this naturalness puzzle? What is a naturalness puzzle? Well, naturalness, in the way I mean it here, is another way of saying genericity. A generic quantum field theory. You take just a typical quantum field theory, and you take its parameters, and you set them at generic values. The properties of that theory will be determined by, more or less, dimensional analysis. Not naive dimensional analysis, but a quantum-corrected dimensional analysis, except when there's some symmetry which allows some physical quantities to be smaller than you would otherwise expect from dimensional analysis. That's essentially what we mean normally by naturalness. Right? It's the behavior of generic quantum field theories, and we know very well how these things work. The principle of naturalness has been a great guide to how quantum field theory works in particle physics, where it's an excellent description. It helps us understand the properties of QCD, the spectrum of bound states and quarks and gluons in particular. It works throughout condensed matter. It works in numerical simulations of quantum field theory. And we have a deep theoretical understanding of it, so we have absolutely no reason to think this principle is somehow just some trivial way of thinking about the problem that's simply evaded. And what is unnatural about the Standard Model is probably best said by saying it's extraordinarily close to a second-order quantum phase transition. By which I mean, if you take the Standard Model, particularly really should think about the Standard Model as coupled to gravity, and you think about it's not only the Standard Model as we know it in nature, but theories like the Standard Model that differ from it only by varying parameters. Yes? I will define it more precisely in a few slides, but I'm...
Just to have a clue.
Okay. The principle is that a natural quantum field theory should be well described by quantum dimensional analysis except when symmetries intervene. Now, it's a concept that you can look at from several different points of view, but that's where one should start. Okay, so let me give you, I'm going to basically give you three different ways of thinking about it, and here's a second one. So, what is unnatural about the Standard Model in particular is that it's so extraordinarily close to a phase transition. Now, let me clarify that in the context of what I said on the previous slide. So, if you take the Standard Model and you vary its parameters, you take a class of theories that are like the Standard Model, the generic quantum field theory, excuse me, the generic version of this theory will either have the property that the H has an expectation value that's fairly large, the particles of the Standard Model will be massive, and the H also will be a massive particle, or you'll find that the H does not have an expectation value, and the Standard Model particles, with the exception of the Higgs, will be massless. There's some subtleties with that, but that's basically the point. And there's some dividing line, some phase transition, where the H is massless, and if you cross this line, the expectation value of the H turns on. And a generic theory will lie somewhere in here, or somewhere in here.
How do you know it's close to a second-order phase transition?
The mass of the Higgs is extraordinarily small. And let me clarify that, because it... Excellent. I'm going to get to that. Right? So, and this is crucial. This is crucial. I will explain it. There's a problem here of just explaining things in a logical order. Okay, so when one says the Standard Model is unnatural, one means that it's extraordinarily close to this line. Now, how close depends on what you think the theory is. If you think the Standard Model is coupled to gravity and nothing else, then you think that the space of parameters here should go all the way up to the Planck scale, the gravitational scale, the scale of the lightest possible black hole, which is 10 to the 18 GeV. And the fact that this particle has a mass of 10 to the 2 GeV is the statement that you're extraordinarily close to this line. Or to be even more precise, if you were to ask, how finely would you have to tune the parameters of the Standard Model so that you would get this close to the dividing line, to the phase transition? And the answer is, well, you'd have to tune the parameters to somewhere of order 1 part in 10 to the 30. So that's the quantitative statement that we're dealing with a theory which is extremely close to a phase transition. You have to tune the parameters of the theory chosen generically to 1 part in 10 to the 30 in order to get as close to the line as nature appears to be. Okay. Now, is that now clear? Okay, good. Now...
One of the reasons to sell the LHC, let's say, was to say that anyway, something, the theory we have, anyway, 5 to the 4th theory is trivial, so something has to happen, and the order of energy where something has to happen is basically what LHC is going to explore.
So
how does this fit with this data? So something was expected really at such a small mass, nevertheless.
Okay, I can't speak to what other people said.
Okay.
What I would have said is, we know that we're missing a particle, at least one, and so we need to build the LHC to find it. Because of the naturalness puzzle, which we knew about, of course, long before, we know the Standard Model has an issue. We do not know for sure that that issue is solved, but if it's solved, the LHC is a good place to go looking for it. But anyone who told you that we were guaranteed, all I can say is, well, you know, I didn't say that. All right, and it's important that there's a difference between knowing that you have inconsistent equations versus knowing that you have a conceptual puzzle. Okay, so, and indeed that's what this slide is about, basically saying what I just said, which is, okay, there was an argument the Standard Model coupled to gravity is highly non-generic, and therefore most experts expected, and I would say I expected, but I knew that it was not guaranteed, that you would find a new symmetry or important new dynamics such that the standard model would be generalized into a new theory, and that theory would be generic. That theory would not suffer from a naturalness problem. So one possibility is that this dividing line is actually a symmetry. I don't know what happened here. This should have been a straight line going right across, and that the generalized standard model would sit very close to this line. For example, that's what happens in supersymmetry. There's a symmetry when the Higgs is massless, and so it's natural that you would sit close to that phase transition. Another possibility is that the space of parameters is very different from what you think. There are new particles, new forces, and so forth. The real space of parameters is deformed greatly, and so in fact, this region which the standard model sits in isn't 1 part in 10 to the 30 of the space, it's 1/10 of it or something. And that's what happens in Technicolor or composite Higgs boson models. Okay, and in both cases, you expect new forces and new particles at the TEV scale generically. Now, this has not happened. The standard model continues to work. You could ask, is our understanding of naturalness just wrong? And I think it's important, because that's an obvious question, to remind ourselves what the principle of naturalness really relies on, and how little and how basic are the things that it relies upon. It's really a very simple principle. And although I say this in part because there have been arguments in the literature, technical arguments about mathematical calculations, that, oh, maybe this principle really doesn't apply. But they're missing the basic physics, you can't get around this. And the point is, you know, it's really about zero-point energy, and it's hard to argue that quantum systems, you know, have zero-point energy. Quantum field theory is essentially an infinite number of coupled oscillators per unit volume, so it's got a very large zero-point energy, formally an infinite amount. Now, we don't really know how much it has, because it depends on the distance scale to which the theory is valid. If we assume we're dealing with something like the standard model coupled to gravity, it's valid at least to the Planck scale. And that means we probably have, from this zero-point energy, something of order a Planck scale worth of energy per Planck volume, which is a lot. Now, constant energy doesn't affect the dynamics of particle physics. It does affect gravity, and so you have to worry about this huge constant, because it's a huge cosmological constant, and that's the worst naturalness problem in nature. But we have a problem in particle physics which is, in some sense, distinct from that, because the problem is this number is not a constant in the standard model. It does affect particle physics. It affects the dynamical equations of particle physics, and the reason is that the zero-point energy that comes from each field depends on the mass parameter of that field, and the mass parameter depends, in the standard model, on the expectation value of the Higgs. And therefore, the energy density of the vacuum depends on the Higgs field, which means that the potential energy of the Higgs field is not this simple little thing you put into your Lagrangian. It's given, dominated completely by the huge quantum correction to the Higgs potential that comes from the Higgs dependence of the zero-point energy. Or in diagrams, you better calculate how the zero-point energy, let's say, from the top quark field affects the Higgs boson. And you have to calculate all these graphs, and you have to do this for all the different fields, and the problem is that this one is of order 1 times Higgs to the fourth, and this one is of order Planck scale squared times Higgs squared. So your potential is completely different. All the terms that are massive are of order dimensional analysis now. They're all of order the Planck scale. And so you might like to have a classical potential like this one, which has a minimum where we find it in nature at about 246 GeV. But when you compute the quantum correction, you'll discover either that the potential actually has a much larger scale with a minimum where the Higgs VeV is of order the Planck scale, that's way out in the phase diagram away from this boundary, or you're in the other regime where, in fact, instead of having a minimum here, your minimum is at zero. And the scale of the potential, again, is huge compared to what you started with. So those two different options, again, correspond to sitting deep in these regions far away from this line. And the naturalist puzzle from this point of view is why is the Higgs VeV, the Higgs expectation value, of order 10 to the minus 15 of the Planck scale instead of order 1 or 0? And I used only very basic things about quantum mechanics and the standard model to make this argument. It's really very hard to imagine that it's just some technicality about, you know, integrals that really should be cut off, really should be set to zero, or something like that. It's physics. Okay, so I would argue that our understanding of naturalness is not the problem. It really is true. The light, unprotected spin zero particle defies our understanding of quantum field theory, and the standard model might be the simplest repair for particle physics, But it's also the most radical type of repair, where you put in something you've never seen before in nature and you have good reason to think doesn't exist. And yet, so far, we have some evidence that it might exist. And I want to argue that this problem, and of course one looks back at history, and there's always dangers of looking back in history and drawing the wrong conclusion, but I at least want to point out a historical example of something that has, for me, a similar flavor, at least explains to you why I think this problem is so important. And the problem I want to compare it to is the Michelson-Morley experiment. And this is something I've been saying since the Higgs, since the week the Higgs was discovered. So, the point is, you know, if you think back to the 1880s and 1890s and the people who would sit in this room, they really understood waves. And they were not stupid about it, right? They really understood many examples of waves. They had lots of examples from data. They understood the theory of waves very well. Everybody knew that for waves, you have a deformed medium. And a medium is something to which, with respect to which you can be at rest or not. And you can measure the difference by looking at the speeds of the waves. And it's very simple. It doesn't rely on any complicated physics. It's not some technical argument. And so, you know, when waves were known to be electromagnetic, there was a medium, and there was just a question of looking for it. And Michelson and Morley went looking for it, and they tried a couple of times, and they didn't find it. So what do you do about this? This is a serious challenge to basic concepts. Well, there's a simple, kind of ugly fix, but maybe it's true, which is the ether is pulled along with the Earth. And so it's hard to measure it on Earth. So maybe we need a space-based interferometer if we want to measure this, or we need a very high-precision interferometer. Meanwhile, a few years after that, Fitzgerald and then other people, including, of course, in the end, Lorentz, started asking, well, maybe the problem is that as you move through the ether, matter deforms in some way. There's some strain internal to that has to do with atomic physics that's not very well understood at that point, and maybe that's the explanation. And that's a bigger fix to the problem. It's a little ugly, but there were a lot of things they didn't know about atoms, so, you know, it wasn't crazy. Of course, the correct fix had some of this mathematics, but totally different set of concepts. So, you know, when you're sitting here in 1887, you're not thinking about this yet. And it's not clear which experiment you should do. In fact, the space-based interferometer is probably a bad idea. But you don't know that. So, you know, my point of view is that we are potentially facing something with a similar kind of flavor. We have a null experiment. The LHC has said nothing where we expected it to say something on very basic general physical grounds. And so now we have no idea what's going on. And that might be really crucial. And it might be that, yes, there's just a simple fix, like ether drift. Naturalness is really a good principle. And the problem is that it's just a little bit more delayed than we hoped. Rather than showing up at order 1, it shows up at order 1 part in 100. And so instead of the new particles we're expecting showing up at a TeV, they're at 3 TeV or 4 TeV, just out of reach of the LHC, or maybe not out of reach of the LHC, but out of reach of what the data we have so far. So we'll keep trying, and maybe we'll find them. You know, it could happen. There are other approaches, which I'll mention in this talk, which are that, well, naturalness doesn't work. There is a solution to the naturalness problem. It doesn't work the way expected. There are other solutions which say naturalness is sort of, you have a run around it somehow. But it's quite possible that the real solution to this problem is as far away from us right now as Einstein relativity. We might be touching on the right idea, we might have some of the right math, but it's unlikely we've got the solution. Now, if any part of this is right, we're dealing with a very big, important problem. This would be a less interesting solution than one of these, but at this point, we don't even know what we're supposed to do. And that's the problem, that's the metacrisis in some sense, which is that even just dividing up the possibilities into two classes, we don't know if we're looking for a solution to the naturalness problem of the sort that we were looking for all along, but one that evades the one that gets around the LHC data constraints so far, or if the problem is with the naturalness principle itself, at least as applied to the TeV scale, that there's some way that nature evades it. And even within these cases, there's different subclasses. So there's a need for the community to explore a very wide range of options, because we really don't know what the problem is or what type of solution we're looking for. Okay. All right, I'm now going to turn to some of these solutions and evasions and tell you a little bit about what I do But since this is important in setting up the problem, maybe I should ask if there are any additional conceptual questions. Okay. Wait, yeah. Right. So the point was, you know, when you start with this picture, the problem is that, you know, this picture is very displeasing. So the question is, how can you change it? And obviously, if you have the wrong theory, I mean, this is for the standard model coupled gravity. If you add new things, you need to draw a new picture. And then the question is, well, depending on what you added, that picture may be just as bad as what you had before, or it may be qualitatively different. Now, in the case of supersymmetry, for example, which I'll say a few words about in a minute, there's the very large quantum correction to the Higgs potential is largely canceled. That for every particle whose whose field gives a large zero-point energy that pushes the potential in one direction, there's a corresponding particle that, by symmetry, its field pushes in the opposite direction. They don't cancel exactly, but they cancel 2 of order the TeV to the fourth. Which means that the dimensional analysis now tells you that the Higgs potential is of order TeV squared, which makes it natural that the Higgs expectation value and its mass would be of order the TeV scale. There's only one requirement. The particles that you added, the partners of the particles we know, have to have mass of order the TeV scale, or this doesn't work. And therefore, you should find them at the LHC. So that's the type of logic that you're working with. You have a potential which seems to be of order the Planck scale. You want to make it of order the TeV scale. You do that by adding a symmetry or dynamics, but that symmetry or dynamics has to be at the TeV scale. And therefore, you should find it at the LHC. Okay. Is that? Now, every particular theory has a particular way of doing this, but they all have this character. Okay, so indeed, in supersymmetry or in some of the other examples, the way this tends to work, not from a sort of high-level conceptual point of view, but from the point of view of, you know, technically, how do you actually get this potential to become of order the TeV scale, is that for every particle you know, especially the particles that interact most strongly with the Higgs field and make the largest contribution to the zero-point energy, that there's some corresponding particle, a sort of partner, or maybe multiple partners, that help to cancel the effect of that particle. So for example, the top quark, the W and Z bosons, the Higgs boson itself, these all are relatively heavy particles. They have strong interactions with the Higgs field, and their effects do not cancel amongst themselves, and therefore there must be other things that cancel their effects if the theory is really natural. So the most obvious thing is new particles related to them by some sort of symmetry. They don't have to have the same mass. They can differ by their masses can differ by order of the TeV scale, but they do have to have the same interaction strengths. That's the key. So in particular, for example, I drew this diagram. Well, there needs to be a top partner, some particle, which also contributes such that its zero-point energy, combined with the way that it interacts with the Higgs, cancels off this graph to a large extent. And that requires that the interaction of the top partner with the Higgs be of the same magnitude as that of the top. It doesn't stop there. The zero-point energy of the top quark is corrected by the fact that the top interacts via the strong nuclear force. So there are gluons exchanged across this graph. And it better be the top partner has something else that similarly corrects its zero-point energy, or this cancellation will fail. So what do you conclude from this? Well, it's a bit naive, but at least a reasonable conclusion you might draw is that we need, because the top quark interacts pretty very strongly with the Higgs and pretty strongly with the strong nuclear force, we need a partner particle, which somehow brings in a minus sign so that there's a cancellation here. It has the same Higgs interaction as the top, and it also has the same interaction with the strong nuclear force. And once you conclude that, you have an experimental consequence, because if the top partner, unique among the partners that interact strongly with the Higgs, has this property, then it is easy to produce when you smash two protons together, because inside a collision of two protons, you have gluons all over the place, and the gluon collisions have a good chance of producing these top partners. Okay, so great. That makes the top partners easy to produce, makes them easy to find, and we're not seeing them, therefore they must not be there. Well, we have to be careful with that argument because you can hide these things. First of all, the partners of the W, the Z, and the Higgs itself, they're also important, and they can hide much more easily because they don't have to carry the strong nuclear force, and therefore they're much harder to produce. What about the top itself? Well, just because something is easy to produce doesn't mean it's easy to observe. It depends on how it decays. The standard model produces a huge amount of other processes, and it is quite easy for non-standard model processes to hide in large standard model backgrounds. And how bad the backgrounds are depends, even if you have a large signal, the S over B or S over square root of B depends on how bad the backgrounds are, and that depends on how the new particle that you're producing actually decays. So you have to think about, well, are there some, could it be the particle is there, but it's decaying in some strange way? Another possibility is the argument I gave you about these new particles having to carry standard model quantum numbers is somehow not right. There is, in fact, a loophole. And in that case, the production rate could be very small. Now, what should you do if you're worried about these things? Well, you should be thinking about predicting the backgrounds. It's a standard model problem. You should be thinking about predicting the backgrounds with high precision. The higher precision you get, the more sensitivity you get to small or obscure signals. So this is something which I do. I also think about ways of extracting the backgrounds from data, which is what the experimentalists do a lot when the predictions aren't accurate enough. But ideally, we'd have very high precision predictions. We need more and more precision as we go further, and we want to probe deeper. So this is a big part of what I imagine doing the next few years. Another possibility, which is a little stranger, is what if the decay mode of the top quark is into many particles? Sorry, top partner is into many particles. You produce one particle, but then you end up with seven or eight coming out. Well, the problem is you produce these things in pairs. If these things fall apart, and now you've got 15 or 16 new particles, some of which are quarks and make jets of hadrons, and some of which might be photons or something. Well, perturbation theory in quantum field theory is fine as long as the number of particles in the final state is not too large. But as it becomes large, you end up with very large uncertainties you cannot control. And so theory can only give you a rough estimate. It's not good enough. So then you actually have to go to the data and ask, what does the data tell you about the backgrounds? Which requires some cleverness. You have to ask, okay, where can I study the backgrounds in a place I'm not worried about there being a signal? And how can I extrapolate from that region into the region we're actually trying to make a measurement? Well, this is a theory problem as well as an experiment problem. Somebody has to think about why you can do it this way. And so that's another thing which I do. A third thing which you can worry about, which is sort of specific to the Large Hadron Collider, is you could worry that you produce these particles and then they travel a certain distance. That distance isn't microscopic as you expected, but it's a millimeter or a centimeter or a meter, and then these things decay. And you might say, well, that sounds easy, right? I mean, you don't expect that to happen in a standard model collision. There is nothing which has that much mass and travels, you know, a meter and then decays into a spray of particles. That sounds easy, but the LHC experiments were not designed for this. They could have been, but they weren't. And so, in fact, this is very difficult to do, and you have to develop techniques, which I'll describe a little bit more in a later slide. Let me say a few words about high-precision backgrounds to give you an example of the types of things that one needs to do. So why is it hard to compute the backgrounds to all of these processes? We know the theory, after all. Standard model is well-established quantum field theory. We know it's how it works. We're working in a regime which is mainly perturbative, even. So we're not even worried about non-perturbative effects being a problem. So why can't we calculate? Well, the problem is, in part, that everything at the Large Hadron Collider involves the strong nuclear force. We're colliding protons, so there's always gluons and quarks around, in the initial state at the very least. And the effective coupling of QCD, that is to say, it's a running coupling, so there isn't really a constant there, but what you're perturbing in is of order a tenth. And often there are coefficients of order 3 or 8. And it's just, the expansion is not very, very quickly, I mean, it's, first of all, it's asymptotic, but it doesn't converge even asymptotically very well. So, furthermore, it's worse than that. You're not just expanding the coupling. They're often large logarithms of ratios of energy scales. And so it's really an expansion in a coupling constant times a log, and that can be very slow. And so if you're even working at the first quantum correction, your uncertainties are often 10%, maybe even as bad as 50%. And if you want to make measurements to the few percent level, you are struggling. It can be done in some cases. Especially since there's been an immense advance in the last few years in techniques for calculating in these types of quantum field theories. Absolutely spectacular. Nobody expected it to go as far as it has. These calculations now require considerable expertise. You have some people here who do that, such as David Kossauer. I don't do those calculations. But it's not enough to have done the calculations, because there are lots of things that now we can calculate with high precision that you can't measure with that precision, and vice versa. So a key need is to have enough vision of both what the experimenters can and can't do, and of what the theorists can and can't do, and the limitations of the calculations, that is, say, where they're convergent well and where they're not convergent well, to understand what are observables that can both be calculated and measured with high precision. So this was something that I got involved with recently. This is an attempt to look at a class of processes, production of any pair of particles that are electroweak bosons. That means a photon, a W, a Z, any pair of those. They are related to each other. And it's not immediately obvious if you don't know the model well, because the W's and Z's are massive particles and the photon is massless. The W's are electrically charged, the photon and the Z are not. But in fact, as you go to higher and higher energy, those differences become less and less important. And in particular, the masses become irrelevant at the energy scales that the LHC can now probe, and the particles get reorganized into a triplet of W's and a singlet gauge boson called hypercharge boson. The photon and Z are combinations of one of these W's and this Y. So if you now use these new relations at high energy, you can derive relations between the production processes for these different pairs of particles. It's not immediately obvious what those relations are until you work them out. And one of the things we found was that photon-photon production, Z-photon production, Z-Z production, these are all related to each other at tree level and beyond tree level. Photon plus W, Z plus W, these are related to each other. We went on to study these, the first line here, in great detail with quantum corrections. And we got nice results, which suggest that measurements are possible with uncertainties of about 5% or better. And a key to success here is careful choices about the kinematics. And let me, without going into technical details, let me give you a little bit of a sense of what you have to do this project. So first of all, you have to figure out what the precision variables should be. So that involves looking carefully at the SU2 cross U1 symmetry relations and identifying candidates for ratios of processes where quantum correction should cancel. Then you have to find an observable that isn't going to have those large logarithms of energy scales, because if you don't have that, then your convergence for your perturbation series will be poor. And these are non-standard cuts in experimental searches, but there's the kind of cuts that experiments don't usually do, but they can do. And for the experts, I've said a few things about them here. Then you actually have to look at the QCD corrections at next to leading order, and to the extent you can, to the next leading order, and worry about certain processes where the corrections don't cancel, but they're under control. You have to deal with some subtleties about how you treat photons. And you have to worry about calculations that haven't yet been done at the second order of corrections. And then there are corrections not just from the strong nuclear force, but from the weak nuclear force and electromagnetism that you have to worry about. And those are actually becoming quite interesting at the high energy scales which the LHC can probe. Anyway, that's some of the technicality, but the bottom line is this. 5% uncertainty or better, and a key to doing it is avoiding those large logs by choosing the right cuts. Okay, that's the high precision wing of this type of project. Now, completely, largely different, is worrying about the possibility that you're dealing with something which might not be that hard to measure if you knew where to look, but something about the decays of new particles is so unusual that you really need to have some new ideas about what type of measurement you should do in the first place. Maybe backgrounds will be a problem, maybe they won't be, but let's start by even imagining what can happen that doesn't happen in the usual theory. So one of the things that I was studying about 10 years ago and continue to study now is the possibility, is a way in which standard sorts of models for solving the naturalness puzzle or for any other purpose can be completely changed experimentally simply by having a few new extra particles around. So what would be an example of a problem would be something, a class of theories I call hidden valleys, in which you take the standard model, you take the generalized standard model with some new particles in it, and to this you add a sector of particles that interact with each other, but do not interact via the electromagnetic force, the strong nuclear force, the weak nuclear force, any of the known forces other than gravity. There's some way that they interact weakly with us, but not via the known forces. Now, such particles would be very difficult to produce in general, in sort of ordinary collisions. So they might be very light, because we might have walked right past them in our particle physics experiments without seeing them. On the other hand, you may have a chance of seeing them if you can produce them sometimes. They may decay back to the standard model with a lifetime that's short enough that you can measure it, although it may be relatively long compared to typical particle physics timescales. Now, how can this affect things? So, for example, you might produce the elusive top partner, and it decays to, let's say, a standard model quark, which you see in your detector as a jet, but it's just an ordinary jet, nothing special about it. And then another particle which goes off into this hidden sector. And now, I've drawn some diagram here, but really there should just be a blob. What happens in here is dynamics among these particles that about which we know nothing. So there could be all sorts of interesting perturbative or non-perturbative dynamics seen here. And out the other end comes some, not one, but several hidden valley particles. And then some of those particles decay back to the standard model, and suddenly I have a spray of many standard model particles coming out. So now I have no hope of predicting the backgrounds from simple calculation, but on top of that, I even have an experimental problem. How do we even identify this event as a special event? How do I collect events like this? How do I show that I have more events than I should? Well, there are all sorts of problems here. First of all, one more thing. It's also possible these particles, because they interact so weakly with the standard model, they can very easily have a long lifetime. So this is a case where you very naturally have something decaying in the middle of your detector. And as I already described, that's hard for the experimenters. Not impossible, but challenging. So in this sort of scenario, you run into all sorts of problems you don't run into in sort of typical supersymmetry models, for example. There are theoretical challenges, because if you take a sector of particles that interacts with each other, there are lots of different ways that could happen. And most of them, we can't calculate. If you're dealing with non-perturbative quantum field theory, there's a lot of things we don't know. So that's a problem. So if you even want to say to the experimenters, well, these are the types of things you need to look for, not even worrying about making a specific prediction, but just saying these are the classes of things that you need to have your eyes open for, you have to worry about, for example, models that have confinement of quarks, but that's very different from QCD. So you have to go to your theoretical toolbox and pull out all of the things you know about quantum field theory and say, well, what if that type of theory were sitting in the hidden sector? What would we see? And that means relying on our understanding of how QCD depends on the number of flavors, how the Warnow-Wren expansion works, how the Carroll-Lagrangian works. We need insight from numerical simulations of theories that are different from QCD, such as pure Yang-Nolz theory. We need insights from cases where we have no other tools than string theory. It's via the so-called ADS-CFT correspondence, which describes classes of field theories that we have no other methods for studying, and that behave in ways that are very surprising. And when you're beyond the confinement, there can be dynamics at higher scales above the confinement scale, if there may not be confinement, but in any case, there could be non-perturbative effects away from the confinement scale, and there you have to worry about what we know about conformal field theory. Again, ADS-CFT can help, expansions, dualities, and so forth. You need the whole toolbox if you really want to understand what the experimenters may have to find. If we leave stuff out, they might just walk right past it. There might be new physics in that data that they're just not looking for. The experimental challenges, meanwhile, are also considerable because, as most of you know, the data rate at the LHC, the collision rate, is so high that they have to throw away 99.9999% of the data as quickly as it comes in, within a second. Right? They have a billion collisions per second. They store for posterity 1,000. That's order of magnitude. The numbers are slightly different, but that's basically the point. So obviously, there's an automated system which does that. It's called the trigger system, and you'd better make sure you're triggering on the things that are interesting. And if you don't know what's interesting, you could accidentally miss something, right? And it's gone forever. So it's very important this triggering system be in there now. We can't figure this out 15 years from now. It'd be too late. And as the data rate increases at the LHC, as they get better and better at what they do, you have to keep shifting the trigger because there's more events coming in and you can only store so many. So this is and they're changing the detectors too. They're improving them. Well, this is a constant running battle to keep ahead of. Then it's great that you've got all this data. You've got a billion events stored per year. But you don't have time to look through a billion events by eye. So there's a computer system which analyzes what's in the events. And if the computer system hasn't been told, look for things that look like such and such, that vaguely resemble what you expect, but don't actually look like what you expect, it'll just say, oh, this is some ordinary event. Or it'll say, I have no idea what's going on here, and throw it in a pile that nobody may ever look at. So you have to reconstruct the events. You have to worry about reconstructing them. And then, of course, you have to actually analyze the data, and that means you need to understand the backgrounds to some of these very strange things. And all of these require a theorist who's looking at the theoretical possibilities, understands the experiments, and knows where the weak points are, or this will just slip by. Okay. Now, I'll spend a couple of minutes saying something about the connection of hidden valleys, which is sort of a very general topic, with the specific issue of can you solve the naturalness puzzle. There are a few examples, and they're becoming more interesting now because we didn't find the examples everybody that many people were expecting, which are so-called neutral naturalness models in which the top partners don't carry strong nuclear forces. They carry an interaction of their own, which is related to ours by symmetry. In other words, this diagram, which had a gluon across it in a previous slide, now has some other gluon of some other group, some other interaction, that's related to this one by symmetry, so that these diagrams still cancel. But now, because you're not dealing with top partners with ordinary strong interactions, proton-proton collisions don't produce them very much. They're very hard to see. Fortunately, the hidden gluons may form a hidden valley and give you new unconventional signals. And again, to do this type of calculation, to figure out what sort of signal you would find, you need to use a combination of numerical lattice simulations, basic theory about how QCD works, and knowledge about mixing of the H boson with similar H boson in the so-called in the hidden sector. One thing that happens here, it also happens in much more generally in hidden valleys, is that the H picks up new decays, because the H, which of course can decay to standard model particles, now can start to decay to particles in this hidden valley. And that can produce decays. Here's a very simple example. H goes to a pair of hidden valley particles, which then decay to four or more standard model particles. These are not the sorts of decays that the experimenters were planning to look for, but they happen all the time, as many of us have been pointing out in the theory community. The range of possible decay modes is enormous, and we did a study in 2013 where we organized what was known and also added some new results about 20 different modes, and that has led to I think we're well over 10 analyses of the experiments now. It's important sometimes to organize the literature so that the experimenters have one place to go. And once they have a one-stop shop where they can find all the theoretical information, then they start actually doing the measurements. That's a good lesson. The case where these particles are long-lived, and so these particles out here come out as a spray of particles in the middle of the detector, is much more complicated, requires separate studies. But there have been a number of searches. It's less of a coherent program, but there have been some Atlas and CMS searches. I'm hopeful there'll be a lot more in the next couple of years. And there's even been a new detector proposed to sit outside of Atlas or CMS. It's been proposed by some of my colleagues. All right, that's a good long time about all the wonderful things that may be sitting waiting for us at the LHC. And some of you may be thinking, and certainly somebody in the audience has in mind, complete waste of time. What is this guy doing? Because there's an argument that the standard model plus gravity is all there is, and the naturalness argument has nothing to do with nature. And that argument is that the properties of the world, the properties of particle physics in particular, are determined partly, largely, by a selection bias. Now, this is sometimes called an anthropic argument. I don't like the term anthropics because it has nothing to do with anthropology. It has nothing to do with people. But it does have to do with the basic requirements for some type of life to exist. And it's an argument which some people have very strong emotional reactions to. I don't really understand that. It's a logical possibility, and we should ask, is it logically consistent or not? And do so in a rational way. And if this argument were true, then you might interpret the null result at the LHC as evidence, circumstantial evidence, of course, that the naturalness puzzle is really just evaded. A selection bias of the following form removes it. It says that life is only possible in highly non-generic universes, and that's why we live in a highly non-generic universe. We couldn't live anywhere else. And that's the explanation, and tough if you don't like it. And that's logically consistent, and worse, it's the best argument we have for the worst naturalness problem in nature, namely the cosmological constant. Right? And so some of my colleagues have said, well, gosh, if the worst naturalness problem could be solved this way, the second worst one must certainly also be solvable that way. But this is wrong. Okay? The selection bias argument for the standard model non-genericity has a logical flaw, and it's important to understand that, because otherwise you might really think this is a waste of time, but it's not. So let me give you the cosmological constant related argument. This is the basic argument. The idea is that the universe is vastly larger than we imagine, or at least that we can see. It has many different regions, many different patches, and each patch has different laws of particle physics, and consequently a different cosmological constant. And most of these patches are uninhabitable. Life is impossible there. We live in some little chunk of a favorable patch where life is possible. It's a very unusual patch of the universe. And the reason the universe looks weird is because the generic patches don't allow for life, and we live in a weird one. And why might you believe this? Well, the argument might be strengthened by if you believed in chaotic inflation, which can produce many patches, at least conceptually. If you believe in string theory, you don't really have to believe in string theory per se, but it is true, string theory is a theory where many people believe that it is an example where there could be many different laws of particle physics. That it's not a theory that predicts the laws, it predicts many different possible classes of laws, and therefore, if you have all these patches, they will generically have different laws. And finally, if you combine those to explain the cosmological constant, you can question any of these lines, but it's logically consistent as an argument that our existence, and even indeed that of power plants, that you need power plants, you need engines for life. If you can't make one, you're not going to have any, and so you need at least something like stars. Well, for that, you need long time scales, you need structure, and that can only be found if you have some time and you have some space. And if you have a large cosmological constant, the universe either immediately collapses or blows itself apart, and you don't have any time. So it's a reasonable argument. It's the only known plausible explanation. And why doesn't it work for the Higgs naturalness problem? Why can't we just explain why we're extremely close to that line by the fact that if we were far from that line, life would be impossible? Well, there's an argument which almost gets you there, but it fails. Here it is. All right, here's what I just said. Life requires a long time and a lot of space, and so you need an exponentially small cosmological constant compared to Planck scale. That's a reasonable argument. Here's another. Life requires that complex objects be stable. If every time I make something the size of a bacterium, it collapses into a black hole, I'm not going to have much luck. All right? That means the masses of particles out of which I can make things. So they have to be particles which are not massless, but they have masses that are exponentially small compared to the Planck scale. There must be a hierarchy of scales. Gravity must be weak relative to the other forces for ordinary matter. Otherwise, you have no chance. So it is true, there must be a large hierarchy of mass scales. And it sounds like we're almost there now to an argument that the naturalist problem is explained by this kind of argument. Except, why would life require that the hierarchy be associated with a light scalar particle with nothing protecting it, no symmetries, something that violates naturalness? Why would that happen? Does your life depend on that? I don't think my life depends on that. There might be some theorists whose lives depend on it, but for most of us, no. And so what is happening here? What is this logical argument actually predicting? It's predicting that, yes, there'll be a hierarchy, but that hierarchy will be ordinary. It'll be generic. It won't be some weird thing that violates our understanding of quantum field. It'll be a normal hierarchy, like we've seen all the time. Some natural generic hierarchy like supersymmetry or technicolor. There's other examples. There's a whole set of different possible natural hierarchies. Very hard to imagine getting rid of all of them. So I would claim that a pure anthropic type argument predicts a small cosmological constant, yes, but it predicts a natural hierarchy, and in fact it violates what we see at the LHC. It doesn't support it. So, and to get around this, you really have to jump through some hoops. For lack of time, I won't go through it, but no one has yet come up with an argument that pokes a hole in this one. So that's important, because now we conclude that a purely anthropic argument doesn't work. And therefore, you can't just argue this problem away. You have to come up with dynamics that addresses the problem. Anthropics might play some role, but it can't play the entire role. And that means there's more work to do, both on the theory side and potentially on the experimental side. So even if the naturalist problem is not a good argument, that doesn't mean there's nothing to see at the LHC about it. And it also doesn't mean there aren't some other types of signals, astrophysical or cosmological in nature, for example. An example of this is something known as the relaxion. This was an idea that's been around for a long time that maybe somehow there's sort of a self-organized criticality that you move around in this space and then you stop moving when you just after you cross this line. But no one came up with an example until 2015. So this was an existence proof that it's possible that the Higgs mass starts out over here and the mass gradually decreases over time, and just after it crosses zero, it gets stuck. So it's a dynamical argument. You don't get there because it's the only vacuum in nature. You get there because you're moving around and something happens. Now, this is interesting because when you actually try to make a so-called realistic, I mean, it's not, we don't have complete models of this, but you make something that's realistic at all, it has LHC signals, actually, which is interesting. But there's a conceptual problem, which is as you're moving around in here, the cosmological constant is also changing. So how do you get the Higgs mass to stop where you want it at exactly the same time the cosmological constant is really tiny, instead of order of the Planck to the fourth? So somehow you have to tie these problems together, or strictly separate them, and that is not easy to do theoretically. So one of the interesting points, which is a general point, is that once you introduce cosmology or history into the reasons that naturalness might be evaded, you're tying together other things in cosmology, like inflation, like the cosmological constant, then you have to make them all work. You can't sort of say, well, the Higgs naturalness problem is a particle physics problem, I'll deal with that, and the cosmological constant is a quantum gravity problem, I'll deal with that later. Now they're tied together, and so now the problems have become much harder. So we're nowhere near, I think, a sensible solution. People have had some interesting ideas, I just list a few of them here. They're all interesting and they're all thought-provoking, but they all depend on strong assumptions. And my analysis, at least, suggests that if you try to say, well, let's take each of these ideas seriously, could you really build a serious theory that makes any one of these work? I think at this point the answer is no. They're all ideas, they're ideas with a realization, but they're not ideas with a serious theory behind them. And I think we're a long way from that. But we need to work here. And another place we need to work is in things like this neutral naturalness that I gave you, where the top partners are not charged under strong nuclear force anymore, examples where there's some sort of there are new generalizations of this so-called twin Higgs model that have come out recently. And I have a naturalist solution I invented in 2003 that uses some of the technical details of ADS-CFT, that is to say the correspondence between field theory and string theory, to calculate critical exponents in I was able to show that there's some very strange things that can happen with the renormalization group in these quantum field theories that you would never guess from what we know either from perturbation theory or from QCD. But when you use string theory, you discover there are things that the renormalization group can do which are big surprises. And that allows for a new naturalness solution. The only problem with this naturalness solution, it is a solution to a naturalness problem. It doesn't solve the one we have exactly. It's hard to make a completely realistic model of it. But it is a new solution. So I'm still hopeful maybe I can fix that in some way. But in any case, I doubt any of these ideas are right. At least entirely, the question is whether one of them is the Fitzgerald contraction. Whether one of them is somehow got a piece of the truth, and if we work on it in the right ways and get into the right form, Lorentz will come along, and then some student who is still an undergraduate will walk out into graduate school and say, I see it, and then we'll all be very happy. All right, so in summary, let me just summarize the talk by showing you the logic diagram of what I've been telling you. So here's what we know. From the LHC, the H has been discovered, or at least an H has been discovered. There are no violations of the standard model yet. And the problem is we don't know whether the naturalness problem is solved by some dynamics that's a little strange and doesn't show up so easily at the LHC, or whether it's evaded somehow. And over on this side, the problem is that somehow the top partners, or something like the top partners, either they don't exist in the usual way, or they're hiding from us, either because they're produced in a strange way, or they're decaying in a strange way. And over here, I've argued anthropics would be the easy way out, but it doesn't work, logically. And therefore, we do need new dynamics, and therefore, there's hard work to do. Over on this side, I know what we need to be doing. That's much better understood. We could have a standard solution to the naturalness problem, but some unconventional decays. We couldn't have an unconventional solution, maybe a hidden valley with low production rates, maybe some new H decays. There's probably a lot more examples here. There hasn't been as much work as there should be. And then on the new dynamics side, I listed the three options that people have come up with so far. But again, there's no real theory there. These are just logical options that have been shown to be consistent, but they haven't really been shown to be convincing by any means. And these are certainly not the only boxes. These are the boxes I mentioned in this talk. There are some that I know about that we haven't shown, and probably the most important box here, I don't even know about them yet. So that's what we have to look forward to. So where this leaves us is that ahead of us lie a broad range of tasks. On the one hand, we need to get every bit of information from the LHC that we can, even if that information is null, because we need to know if there's anything that violates the standard model in there or not. And you can't leave stones unturned, because then you don't know what your problem is. So we need high precision, as much high precision information here as we can get. We need to be exploring solutions to the naturalness puzzle that easily hide from the LHC, and we need to be looking for solutions that involve history and cosmology that evade the usual naturalness puzzle. And those, I think, are the main tasks, at least that I see for myself in the coming years. And I will stop there. Thank you. The problem is it's between this step and this step.
So if you knew the theory was the standard model with one scalar,
okay, good.
Apply,
so now we get into the good. This is an important subtle point, which is that you're right that one of the ways out is you imagine that the fundamental theory of the world doesn't have any natural hierarchies, such as if the fundamental theory of the world were that I have the standard model particles, and the only thing I can vary is the parameters of that theory, then indeed, the only hierarchy you can have is an unnatural one, and since a hierarchy is required, it'll be an unnatural one. The question is, do you or does anyone else know of a way to make a fundamental theory that consists of the standard model particles only, where the only thing that changes is the parameters of the theory? Well, string theory certainly doesn't do that, so we can forget about that one. And the point is that you have to now address the questions of quantum gravity. So it is true that one possible solution that gets around my argument is that somebody comes up with a fundamental theory that has no natural hierarchies. Now, on the other hand, you have to be very clever, because you have to have come up with a way of getting no natural hierarchies for electroweak physics, but the natural hierarchy of QCD is still allowed. So this can't be a very principled argument. It has to somehow say, well, look, just as you said, the only thing that's available is standard model particles, and so, look, that's all you can do. But even that argument has been poked, a hole has been poked in that, in a paper that was called The Weakless Universe, which pointed out that if you took the Higgs-Vev to be the Planck scale, and you conversely took the Yukawa couplings, which set the masses of the electron in the top quark, and you took them to be exponentially small, you would end up with a world which doesn't have everything that we have, but there's no obvious reason it can't have stars and it can't have structure, has nuclei. And so, unless you can prove that can't possibly happen, that's a way out where you generate a different type of hierarchy. It's perfectly natural, even just with a standard model. So it's really hard to come up with a theory that is of this type. But I don't say it's impossible. I do say that people who are interested in this problem should be working on this rather than just throwing up their hands and saying, I'm sure the anthropic solves the naturalness puzzle, which a lot of them are doing. I think one should take this a little more seriously. Yeah?
Concerning the hidden particles, if I understand it well,
So, for those, that's an excellent question, and indeed, there's sort of two different. So, when talking about hidden valleys, there are different ways you can approach the question. One is you can say, I have no idea how naturalness is addressed within our sector, but look, I have an experiment that's running, and I need to make sure I don't miss anything that's in the data. And in that case, you would say, I don't know how to solve the naturalness problem in the standard model. I don't know how to solve it in that sector. Maybe they're related to each other. But in any case, the most important thing is that we not miss something that's in the data. Okay, so that's one approach. And so part of my work is just making sure we don't miss something, because I know there's a lot of things that we theorists don't understand. Now, if you ask, OK, can we make a serious model? Then the answer is, well, it depends. If you have supersymmetry, for example, maybe just above the TV scale, just out of reach, that can affect both sectors. So that's one way that they can be protected. It is possible that in the hidden sector, the hierarchies there are just natural, like those in QCD, as a second possibility. Third possibility, such as in the twin Higgs, you need to tie together the hierarchies in the two sectors. And in some cases, that's easy. In some cases, that's not. But you're absolutely right. If you want to build a complete theory of the hidden valley sectors, then you need to address all the same types of problems. It's just that you don't have to necessarily have a Higgs in that sector, so you don't necessarily have a naturalness puzzle there. However, the big picture has a naturalness puzzle. So you still have, you know, how does this hidden valley combined with the standard model solve its naturalness problem? You have to address that if you want to be, you know, if you really want to address it properly at a theoretical level. However, you know, as I said, you know, because of the experimental challenges, particularly the triggering, we don't really have time to wait for people like, you know, those in this room to be clever enough to solve the naturalness problem once and for all. Because if we don't trigger in the data the right way, and then we figure out what the model was, and we figure out, oh, it had this great signal, but you didn't trigger on it, and the machine is already turned off, that would be pretty upsetting. So we have, because of the urgency of the experimental issues, we have to address some of these problems before they're ripe for experimental reasons. If in 5 years from now there's nothing found at the LHC, what would I choose to work on? Well, that, that's of course a little hard to guess, because there'll be 5 years of theory between now and then. If the theory were in the situation it is now, I would say the problem is still there. You could just as well ask me, what would you do if Michelson and Morley's second experiment finds nothing? I would not then say, well, this is not a problem, there's nothing I can do about it. I would say the theoretical problem becomes deeper. The experimental problems also in a way become deeper, because 5 years from now there'll still be more data coming. So let's say even 10 years from now, when the LHC is, they won't really be done, but maybe you'd argue that, okay, they're at a point of diminishing returns. This obviously will depend on what else is going on over a 10-year period in data. Obviously, gravitational waves by that point, maybe even by the end of this year, may become an area of major exploration. It depends. I mean, I'm certainly, you know, paying attention to that kind of stuff. I pay attention to a lot of experiments. The reason the LHC is important for me is, first of all, it probes the TV scale, and I know we have a theoretical problem there. And second of all, essentially, it's one experiment that can do hundreds of measurements. Most of the other facilities we have can do one measurement or two. And you know, that's not true of the flavor physics community, but it is a reason why I concentrate on the LHC. It seems to me we have the best chances there. And it's complicated, and so a theorist like me has a lot to do. So if nothing happens experimentally and nothing happens theoretically, I see no reason to change this program. But I also am well aware that might come an experiment that would completely change what needs to be done. Just in the same way that once we found the H and didn't find something else, the problems changed and we had to address that. Obviously, if we find something in one of the other experiments, the problem has to be looked at again. So it's impossible to give a completely general answer to that. But I'm wedded to this experiment because this is where the problem is. If the problem changes, you know, so will my plans. It is possible. It is possible. It's difficult. There's sort of two types of answers to that you could give. One is, we don't at the moment know of enough conceptual reasons why quantum gravity would affect this problem. People have tried, of course. And up to now, we don't have examples. We should search for such examples, but there's no guarantee we're going to find them, of course. Another possibility is, you know, for example, the anthropics problem. If you wanted to apply anthropics, that's a quantum gravity problem. Right? I mean, the understanding what the space of vacua is in a theory requires you to understand the energetics of it, and you don't know that you understand the energetics if you don't understand how quantum gravity really works and how it picks out vacua. So, for example, if your quantum gravity theory has the property that some vacua don't even have four-dimensional gravity, then that's very different than if they all do. So the further we go along this route, the more the naturalist puzzle does not seem to be solved self-consistently within particle physics, the more we have to worry that, indeed, quantum gravity has some role to play. But, I mean, that's a difficult theory problem. It needs to be worked on. At this point, we have no reason to think it, but that doesn't mean the answer is it doesn't.